Welcome back. In last lecture, we saw what is flexibility method. It is also nothing but a superposition method where you convert an indeterminate structure into determinate structure, and whatever released structure you have developed or whichever support you have removed to convert the indeterminate structure into released structure, determinate structure, that support later on you replace by a unit load. That means the reaction at that support you replace by a unit load, and then you define flexibility. When we have a problem where degree of static indeterminacy is 2 or more, like 2, 3, 4, then we will be relieving those many supports, 2 supports, 3 supports, and then we will be successively applying unit load at those supports in place of their reaction. That is where we require to define not just flexibility, but flexibility coefficients. So today in the beginning we will see what is flexibility coefficients, and then whatever I said in the introduction, as we solve a numerical example, you will perfectly understand. We already have defined flexibility as displacement due to and corresponding to unit action. Many students do not understand the difference between due to and corresponding to. Try to understand, when I apply a unit couple movement, because of that couple movement, there might be a deflection, there might be a slope. So due to only points out that because of some action. But when I use the word corresponding to, it becomes very clear to us that if its action is couple movement, then the corresponding displacement is only rotation or slope. If the action is a force, unit force, then the corresponding displacement has to be deflection. So due to and corresponding to, both are equally important, and actually both are pointing at different aspects. So I repeat, flexibility is the displacement due to unit action, but which displacement, it is corresponding to our unit action. Now we come to defining flexibility coefficient I and Z. And like stiffness coefficient, the first subscript I indicates the location of consequence, and the second subscript Z represents the location of cause. I repeat, I represents the location of effect and Z represents the location of the cause. So how do we define FIZ, flexibility IZ? It is going to be displacement at node I. That means the location of displacement, the location of consequence or effect is I. Due to and corresponding to, as we discussed here, due to and corresponding to, unit action at node Z. So our action, our cause is acting at Z, and the displacement which has got generated at I, that displacement we are calling as flexibility. Why we are calling it as flexibility? Because our action at node Z is unit action. Unit couple movement, unit applied force, whatever it is. So corresponding to unit action, whatever displacement I am getting, it is my flexibility. But I represents location of displacement and Z represents location of unit action. So I repeat, what is flexibility coefficient FIZ? It is displacement at node I. Due to and corresponding to unit action at node Z. So using this basic concept, we shall be defining F11, F12, F13 likewise. So let us solve one numerical example on degree of static indeterminacy 2. So that first of all we will understand how to make use of this IJ, how are we applying superposition equations, how those equations are formulated, how they are converted into a simple matrix form equation, and how do we get the solution. Once that is understood in a basic problem, then we can explore the further avenues like degree of static indeterminacy 3, sinking of support frames, non-sway frames, sway frames, likewise. So here is our first problem of flexibility method with degree of static indeterminacy 2, and we will come to know how to write or how to make use of the flexibility coefficients. So this is our beam, a continuous beam with fixed support at end A, interior roller at B, exterior roller at C, and then we have a UDL acting over the entire continuous beam of intensity 20 kilonewtons per meter, and the spans are A to B 6 meters and B to C 4 meters. So I observe the given numerical, I try to show the unknown support reactions. Fixed support, there are going to be MA, VA, and I am ignoring HA. RB, normal reaction by roller support. RC, normal reaction by roller support. So in all, there are 4 unknown support reactions and only 2 equations of equilibrium, ignoring of course sigma fx equal to 0 equation. So that is what I have written in my opening statement. Degree of static indeterminacy is unknown reactions 4 minus available equilibrium equations 2, that is 2. So our DSI is 2, then it is our choice to choose which forces are redundant forces, unnecessary forces, without whom also equilibrium theoretically would have been possible, and of course we are choosing RB, support reaction RB and support reaction RC as the redundant forces. So if I remove those two supports, my beam, my structure will simply be a cantilever beam. So that is what I am doing. I am choosing RB presumably upwards as my redundant Q1, and I am calling joint B as node 1. So whenever number 1 appears, numeric 1 appears, it is corresponding to B, node B. I am calling node C as node 2, and then I am calling the corresponding support reaction, unknown support reaction RC, presumably upwards as Q. Now what I will do, instead of explaining all these calculations, I will first theoretically discuss the total problem on the diagrams. Since we have already done stiffness method, we are very well aware how these superpositions we carry out. We have also solved one prop cantilever in flexibility method. So I am sure you will understand these drawings and you will understand the superposition and you will understand the notations very well. Once all this is understood, we simply go for discussion of calculations, and that will be the end of our discussion. That will be the complete understanding for you of the solution. So let's see what we have here. This is my given beam. Now how am I solving it? How am I approaching it using flexibility method? What is my methodology? So I convert this beam into, or I split this beam into a couple of determinate beams. This is indeterminate beam, so I split it into a few determinate beams such that their compilation, their superposition gives me my original beam back. For example, I start with released beam with loads as my first part. So what have I done? I have gotten rid of support C as well as support B. When I remove those supports physically, though theoretically, though in imagination, when I remove those supports, of course RB and RC forces are no more existing. So one part of my original configuration is this cantilever beam which is carrying loads. Same 20 kN per meter intensity UDL throughout the span. So observe this diagram. This is a determinate beam because it is only a cantilever beam. It has got only one support at the left end, that is end A. So we are calling it released beam with loads. Remember, I am not saying that this is same as this, but I keep on saying this is only one part of this and the remaining parts are coming up. Now about the notations. This particular vertical deflection I am calling as DQL1. What is the meaning of DQL1? It is displacement corresponding to Q1 because of loads. It is very obvious that this cantilever, because of the gravity loads, because of the UDL, will deflect somewhat like this. These diagrams are not to scale. You are not to compare anywhere. This much is deflection by 20 kilonewtons per meter. This much is deflection by unit load. How is it possible? No, not at all. These are schematic drawings, not to scale, only representative drawings. So coming back to DQL1 means displacement corresponding to Q1 due to loads. What is Q1? Q1 is RB. That means a force reaction, not a moment reaction, but a force reaction. So corresponding to force, my displacement has to be a deflection, not rotation. So though we have some theta B here, I am not paying attention to it. My focus is deflection B to B prime, which I am calling as DQL1 because it is happening at node 1. Similarly, observe this deflection. Why deflection? Why not observe slope? Because our Q2, our redundant is RC. And what is the meaning of DQL2? It is a displacement corresponding to Q2. Corresponding to Q2, Q2 is RC, so it has to be a deflection, not a slope. So DQL2 has been shown as this deflection, and it is of course because of the original span loads, gravity loads. So my first diagram, after the original configuration I have drawn, my first diagram in the superposition methodology, which I call as M diagram, is released beam with loads, and there I am defining DQL at node 1 corresponding to Q1 and DQL at node 2 corresponding to Q. These notations we have to remember, and if we remember their full form, it is displacement corresponding to redundant Q2 because of loads. Once that is understood, remembering these is not difficult at all. So that is my first part. Now I go to second part, where what we are doing, instead of directly applying this entire RB, I am applying unit load. What is the significance of this? Using unit load method, I am able to calculate all these displacements. Even these displacements I am able to calculate when I apply unit load here. Very frankly speaking, actually my superposition is this plus this beam with RB and this beam with RC. But when I directly show RB and RC there, though my superposition is correct, I am unable to calculate DQL1, DQL2 and rest of the displacements. So to enable myself to apply unit load method, we have adopted this kind of elegant approach that we apply here unit load rather than entire RV. So I am applying unit load, that is I am saying Q1 is equal to 1. Now whenever I apply unit action, corresponding displacements are going to be flexibilities, because flexibility is the displacement due to and corresponding to our unit action. Unit action is force. So again, whatever flexibilities I am defining, they are going to be deflections, not slopes. Now observe the flexibilities. This particular displacement, because of this unit load, I am calling as F11, simply meaning it is a displacement at node 1 due to unit load at node 1. The first suffix, the first subscript indicates location of displacement, and the second subscript indicates location of unit load. Here both are 1. It is displacement at 1 due to unit load at 1, and unit load, when I say, the displacement is called as flexibility, hence the notation F. So we are calling this displacement as F11. Now observe this displacement, which has occurred simultaneously. Though my force is applied here, and in this portion there is no bending moment. In fact, this portion has just gone up and remained straight here. There is a bending here. There is no bending here. This portion is straight. Nevertheless, there is going to be some CC prime. C is moving to C prime. C is our node 2. So this particular displacement, or rather deflection, not slope but deflection, I am defining as F21 for the simple reason it is displacement at node 2 due to unit load at node 1. Displacement or flexibility at node 2 due to unit load at node 1. That is why I am calling it as F21. This is my second part of the superposition. And now I go ahead with applying unit value of Q2. Again, I am not directly applying RC, I am applying unit value of Q2, so that I am able to, as you can clearly see here, or you can clearly see in the table also, I am able to apply unit load method to get all my displacements. Those displacements, using those displacements, I am writing compatibility equation, superposition equation, and I am getting all my answers. So, in the third part, or in the last part of my process of splitting, so that finally I can go for superposition, instead of applying total RC, I am applying unit value of RC. I am writing here Q2 is equal to 1. I am writing released beam with Q2 equal to 1. Here I have written released beam with Q1 equal to 1. Since it is Q1 equal to 1, this diagram we call as M1 diagram. Since this is Q2 equal to 1, this diagram I am calling as M2 diagram. Observe the flexibilities. This displacement, which is due to Q2, which is equal to 1, at 2, due to load at 2, displacement at 2, due to load at 2, I am calling as F22, flexibility 22. And when I apply this force, of course B is also simultaneously going up to B prime. That displacement, that deflection, I will call as flexibility at node 1 due to unit load at node 2. So it has to be F12. So this is my superposition, and these are all my parameters. At node 1 and 2, I have DQL1, DQL2 due to gravity loads. I have F11, F21 due to unit load at node 1. And I have F12 and F22 due to unit load at 2. Once this superposition is understood, or once this splitting, this resolution is understood, now we are in a position to just calculate parameters, substitute in our compatibility equation and get the answer. Again, like previous problem, what I will do, rather than discussing this, because see, this is a formality. Calculation part is not conceptual, it is mathematical, it's a formality, it is application of mathematics to mechanics. Mechanics is here, and for that matter, mechanics is here. So let me first explain this, and then I will just, as a formality, finish the calculation part. And this is exactly the mistake that students are doing. They are too much focused upon marks. They are too much focused upon calculations. And they have not understood what really is going on in the method. They just remember a few steps. They feel they should do the calculations correctly and they should get the marks. No, no, fine. You have to achieve marks, but more than that, you have to understand concepts. So whatever superposition I tried to explain in drawings, now let us see how I apply these in my equations. For that I have written compatibility equations. That means now we are going to discuss the possible displacements and their superposition. My first term on LHS is dq1. What is the meaning of dq1? It is displacement in original configuration corresponding to q1. My q1 is RB. RB is a force. So at B point, whatever deflection I will get up or down, that is my dq1. Now of course, when you have a roller support here, you do not expect any deflection there. You may expect slope, but corresponding to RB, my redundant, the deflection is going to be my dq1. Deflection is going to be my expected displacement, which is 0 in the original given configuration. So this dq1 is nothing but 0. And now what am I trying to say in my superposition? I am saying that since this diagram is equal to this diagram plus this into RB plus this into RC. Why am I saying this into RB, this into RC? I tried to explain in the last problem also. This is effect of 1. So what will be effect of RB? It will be multiplied by so many times. That is, it will be multiplied by RB. This is also effect of 1. Whatever you are observing, whether it is shear force, bending moment, slope, deflection, whatever. Whatever effect we want to discuss, if it is due to unit load, then due to RC, it will have to be multiplied by that much amount, that means RC. That's why I keep saying that this configuration is this plus this into RB plus this into RC, and that is precisely what I have written in my first equation, for that matter in my second equation. I am simply trying to say that the deflection at B in original B should be equal to this deflection dql1 plus this deflection f11 into RB plus this deflection f12 into RC. Just see if I have the same equation or not. It is dq1 is equal to dql1 plus f11 into q1 means RB plus f12 into q2 means RC. Just observe, each term in this equation, you carefully try to find in your diagrams and you will immediately be able to relate, array, it is so simple. If this is equal to this plus this into RB plus this into RC, it is true for all parameters, for all physical quantities, so it is also true for the deflection at B, which happens to be zero, fine. If the same problem comes with sinking of support, I will have a non-zero term here. The support is sinking by 2 millimeters, so I will be substituting negative 2 here. Sinking down, that's why negative, nothing else. Coming back to this deflection is equal to this deflection plus F11 into Q1 plus F12 into Q2. That is what I have done. Along the same lines, I will say this deflection that is dq2, I have written here, it is displacement or deflection in original beam corresponding to q2. Again, no sinking of support or nothing is mentioned. Our focus is force redundant, so our focus is deflection, not slopes. So very clearly, at this exterior molar also, there is not going to be any deflection. There is going to be zero deflection. But what I am trying to convey is, I am saying this deflection is equal to this deflection plus this into Rb plus this into Rc, that is into Q1 and into Q2. Effect by unity, effect by Rb, effect by Rc, just multiply. So just see if that is what I have written or not. dq2 is equal to dqL2 plus F21, where are we? Yes, F21 into Rb, that is what I have written, Q1, plus F22 into Rc, that is Q2, that is what I have written. Now, observing these two terms and these four terms, it strikes our mind that it is possible to express these two algebraic equations, linear equations, in simple matrix form, and that is what I do. These two form a vector of dq, these two form a vector of dql, this into this plus this into this, this into this plus this into this, this can be expressed in a simple matrix multiplication form. F11, F12, F21, F22 into Q1 and Q2, which are appearing as common parameters. So I convert observing these equations into this matrix equation. Column matrix, we call it vector. Another vector, square matrix, flexibility matrix or flexibility coefficient matrix. And this is our unknown redundant support reactions vector. Vector means column matrix. So I express this equation in a notation form, simple form like this. Vector dq is equal to vector dql plus matrix f into vector q. So henceforth I will not be expressing all these equations like this and explaining the same superposition again and again. That is not possible. We do have some time constraint. At a later stage, if you feel that you are not following this or you are not actually getting the idea of superposition or you have forgotten, you can always come back to this problem. You can always go through this video. You can always understand it and then proceed further. Coming back to, I arrive at this compatibility equation or this superposition equation, and now I go back to this table, which is, as I was saying, a formality of application of unit load method and applying mathematical equations or formulae or calculations to get our answers. Because if you look at this compatibility equation, these two are zeros, but these and these I have to calculate, and these are unknowns, Rb and Rc, which we are trying to find anyway. So I start with my unit load method table, span origin limits M, M1 and M2 now. There are two redundants. There are two spans, span CB, span BA. Now I don't need to look at this original beam. I am solving this as M diagram, this as M1 diagram, this as M2 diagram. So for span CB, I choose C as origin. Limits will be 0 to 4, that is this distance. When my section moves from C point to B point, I have covered 0 to 4 meters. That's why limits are 0 to 4. And then I express bending moment at any arbitrary position between C point and B point. It is going to be 20 into x into x by 2. In case you are not following, I would like to show. This is our section and this distance is x and C is the origin. So my bending moment is going to be 20, which is the intensity, into x squared by 2, hogging, so negative.
That is what I have written here. Similarly, if you look at the next span, that is BA, that means this span, then if my section goes here, but origin is same, that is C, that is what I have written here. Origin is C, but B to A span, so my section is moving from B point to A point, so obviously it is covering a distance or a segment of 4 meters to 10 meters, because this is 6 meters, so that's why I am writing limits as 4 to 10. And again, when my section is here, I am going to get bending moment expression same, that is negative 20 into x by 2, so that is what I have written here, negative 20 x squared by 2. So I hope you have followed these columns so far perfectly. Spans I have written, origins I have written, limits I have written. These are going to be same whether you are discussing M or M1 or M2 or whatever. These expressions, bending moments, you have to write carefully. So now I go ahead with M1 diagram. That means I am looking at this diagram. As far as span CB is concerned, as we discussed a few minutes back, there is no bending moment here. So I am writing 0. As far as span BA is concerned, there will be bending moment. It is going to be 1 multiplied by this much distance, wherever is my section up to that section. Now that distance is going to be total x minus this 4 meters distance, because my origin is C. I am counting my x from C, but my span is B to A. So this much distance is going to be, I don't know how much confusing it is or whether I am going very fast or whatever. So anyway, I will try to explain. This is my section xx. And understand please that this whole distance is x, because my origin is written as C. So if this whole distance is x, this much distance from my force, unit load, is going to be x minus 4. This is x, this is 4, remaining is x minus 4. So my bending moment is going to be 1 into x minus 4 and sagging, so it is going to be positive, and that is what I have written here under M1 diagram. It is 1 into x minus 4. And now we come to M2 diagram, which is here. And you are observing that the point load, the unit load, is acting at the free end, whether you consider this span or this span. For the sake of again total understanding, I am showing the section here. This distance we are calling as x. Why this is x? Because our origin is C, so I am calculating variable distance x from C point. This is my section. Whether the section is here or here, you are observing that there is only this load acting, and it will create 1 multiplied by x, sagging, bending moment. That's why I have written here for span CB also, as well as for span BA, it is 1 into x and 1 into x. So that is how appears our table. I urge you to observe these drawings carefully. Compare these drawings with the entries in the table. See that you are understanding M, M1 and M2 for both these spans. Because if you commit a small error here, our further calculations and then obviously our final answers are going to go wrong. So just be very careful about writing these entries of bending moments in the table. Choose your origin carefully so that your work is convenient for calculation. Great, once the bending moments are in place for the different spans, for the different diagrams M, M1, M2, then what remains is very simple unit load integration calculations. So those I have shown separately in the extreme right column of our board. I am writing DQL1 is equal to integral 0 to L capital M, M1 dx upon EI. Since this is DQL1, I am writing MM1 dx upon EI. Simply substitute from this particular table. It is going to be integral 0 to 4, this into this with respect to x, upon EI plus integral 4 to 10 this into this with respect to x upon EI. See that exactly the same things I have written there. This minus 20 x squared by 2 I have just simplified as minus 10 x squared. That minus 10 is minus 20 by 2. Nothing else. And then I solve these integrations and I am getting negative 11880 over EI. Negative indicates downwards, and that is what we anyway know from our diagrams. Then I calculate DQL2 is equal to integral 0 to L MM2. This is 2, so this is M2. M is same. Original diagram with loads is same. Released beam with loads is same. So DQL2 is equal to integral 0 to L MM2 with respect to x upon EI. So again I substitute carefully from my table. It is M into M2. So it is going to be integral 0 to 4 this into this plus integral 4 to 10 this into this MM2. So you can observe that is what I have written here. Minus 20 by 2 converted as minus 10 x square into x, x square into x. Actually, since these integrands are same, you could directly have combined them in one integration saying 0 to 10. That was also possible. And then you solve this, you are getting negative 25,000 over EI. Again downwards, as expected, as already known was. Then I go ahead with calculation of flexibility coefficients. F11 is integral M1 M1 dx over EI, means M1 square. So simple. I have M1 here for both the spans. My first integration is integral 0 dx between 0 and 4 limits. That is anyway vanishing, that is giving me 0. The second integration is integral 4 to 10 x minus 4 into x minus 4. That is what I have written here as x minus 4 bracket square dx over EI. Please calculate carefully. I am getting F11 as 72 over EI. Next, I am calculating F12 is equal to F21 as integral M1 M2 dx upon EI. See, if you see, even if you don't remember the unit load method, actually these expressions are very simple to remember. DQL1 means M into M1. DQL2 means M into M2. F11 means M1 M1. F22 means M2 M2. F12 means M1 M2. Like that. So, I am getting M1 M2 with respect to x upon EI. So, this is the product. This into this, this into this. So, my first term is integral 0 to 4, this into this, that vanishes. And second term, integral limits 4 to 10, this into this, with respect to x upon EI. That is what I have written here. And I am getting F12 is equal to F21 is equal to 144 upon EI. Why am I saying F12 is equal to F21? Because for F12, if it is M1 M2 dx upon EI, for F21 it will be M2 M1 dx upon EI. So my calculation is going to be same, M1 into M2 or M2 into M1. So here again we see, like stiffness coefficient, Sij was same as Sji. In the same way, Fij is same as Fji. That is, your flexibility matrix is also symmetry matrix. So F12 same as F21, and my calculation is yielding 144 over E. Lastly, I calculate F22. Expression now I am sure you can write on your own. It is going to be integral 0 to L M2 M2 dx over EI. This is my M2. This is my M2. For both the spans 0 to 4 and 4 to 10, it is going to be M2 square, and M2 square means x square and x square. That is what I have written separately. 0 to 4 x square dx over EI. 4 to 10 x square dx over EI. You might have combined and written 0 to 10.
x square dx over er. The calculation is fuzzy. 1000 upon 3 er. That is 333.3333 upon er. That's it. Do these calculations carefully. See that you understand the expressions. See that you catch the trick in remembering and writing these expressions from unit load method. Do the calculations carefully. You will get all these answers. Now your DQL1, DQL2, F11, F12, F21, F22, you substitute here. This is unknown. Q1 is nothing but RB. This is unknown. Q2 is nothing but RC. These four you have found. These two you have found. And these two we have already discussed as zeros. Substitute. Solve these equations as simultaneous equations. You will be getting Q1, that is your RB, is equal to 110.3 kilonewtons. Positive answer means presumed upward sense has found out to be correct. And you will get Q2 is equal to RC is equal to 27.35 kilonewtons. Again, positive answer means this assumed sense was correct. So this is a force method. We start with unknown support reactions as redundants and we eventually get unknown support reactions answers. Once you find these two answers, think of FBD of the original beam, that is this original configuration. By the way, you may draw UDL this way or this way. It is one and the same thing. I am just touching upon a point which is very well known to all of us. This you have found just now. This you have found, only two unknowns would remain. I have written their answers after calculation, but when you draw the FBD, these two you have just now succeeded in determining. MA is unknown, VA is unknown. Apply sigma FY equal to 0, you get answer for VA. Apply sigma M about A equal to 0, you get answer for MA. All unknowns are found, then you can go for SFD, VFD, deformed shape or elastic curve or whatever. So yes, this is how we solve a problem by flexibility method. Again, very simple and as systematic as a stiffness method, except that in stiffness method we have some standard results that we are applying, whether it is actions corresponding to fixity or whether it is due to unit displacements, whatever it is. We just make use of standard results every time. Whereas here we are applying unit load method and some integration calculations are involved, that's all. Otherwise the method is as systematic as stiffness method. So we have solved one problem using degree of static indeterminacy 2. And then we had 4 flexibility coefficients, 2 by 2 flexibility matrix. In next problem, we will see 3 unknowns and then 3 by 3 matrix, 3 equations to be solved simultaneously.